Good morning, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Smart City Smart Mobility Conference, organized by Hotel Icon in collaboration with Charge Hong Kong. I would like to extend a warm welcome to all of you, and thank you all for joining us this morning. I am Megan from Global Brand Marketing, and it is my pleasure to be your host today. Please find on the screen the free Wi-Fi password as well as the QR code to Slido. You're all encouraged to use Slido to ask any questions that you would like during the forum. The future will not only be smart mobility, but smart cities as well. So the real question is smart mobility the way of future, and what are its benefits? With the support of leaders in this industry and likewise individuals, we are privileged to have this possibility to make this change. To begin this program, I would like to invite Richard Hatter, General Manager of Hotel Icon, to deliver his opening remarks. Please.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you, Megan. Megan is one of our elite management trainees, so she's interning in Hotel Icon at the moment. Hotel Icon is, as you know, probably that it's a teaching research hotel, fully owned by Hong Kong Polytechnic University, and part and parcel of the School of Hotel and Tourism Management. So one of our missions is to establish ourselves as a thought leader. So we have a series of four forums every year. The next one we will do is on cybersecurity and how it impacts the hotel industry and various others through the year. So this year's Smart City Smart Mobility Conference is really a sequel to the Electric Vehicle Forum, which we did last May. And last year, Hotel Icon shared our experience as an early adopter with our 100% electric fleet, transportation fleet, which we use for all our customers and shuttle. We were also really thrilled to have a really robust panel of speakers on EV, and a lot of people came up to me afterwards and said it would be great to continue this. So this year, our aim is to provide you as stakeholders, as well as the general public, with a kind of local platform to engage in the topic. So what we're going to explore is technology and the best practices for turning a smart city plan, the Hong Kong Smart City Plan, into reality. And we'll be focusing on smart mobility and transportation. And that's an area where there's been such a tremendous amount of transformation. It's also a great way for you to just network with other evangelists. The topics will be ranging from smart city case studies from Sweden and from the Netherlands to renewable energy, smart charging infrastructure, urban informatics in Hong Kong. And the idea is really to promote dialogue. So I just wanted to thank a few key people who are in the audience. And first of all, we have the honorary Kenneth Leung, who's a LegCo member. Thank you, Kenneth, for coming on talking to us. We have from the academia circle, Professor John Shi from Hong Kong PolyU. John. And Professor Kevin Choi from Clemson University. A big thank you to Helena Storm, the Consul General of Sweden in Hong Kong and Macau, Helena, and her colleague Magnus Carnwall, who actually flew in from Beijing. He's based at the Embassy of Sweden in Beijing. We also have some independent consultants, Mark Van Kerkhoff, who also flew in. He arrived last night, and we need to keep him loaded up with coffee in case he gets jet lag. Mm-hmm. And also Paul Bromley. Paul has a fleet of, please stand up, buses, that electric vehicles, rather like ones we have, and they're all manufactured in the UK. And we've also got other partners, including Tesla Tesla, we have five of their vehicles using as our guest limousine service. They've been very supportive. We got a big thanks to CLP, Hong Kong EV Power, and of course, last but not least, Mark Chapman, who is heads up Charged Hong Kong, who I'm going to hand over to now. Anyway, have a great day, and I hope you enjoy it, and thank you very much for all our contributors. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Hatter, for the remarks. Now may I invite Mark Webb Johnson, co-founder and chairman of Charge Hong Kong, to deliver his opening remarks, please.
Good morning. I'd like to start by welcoming everybody to this Smart City, Smart Mobility conference. We've got a great lineup of speakers today, and I'm looking forward to hearing from their expertise. But before we start, like Richard, I'd like to thank some people. This is the second year that we've worked with Hotel Icon to organize these conferences, and I can say that everybody in the electric vehicle community in Hong Kong is so very appreciative of all that Hotel Icon does for sustainability and for electric vehicles here in Hong Kong. They truly are an icon in how they show how the hotel industry can act in a sustainable manner. And in particular, their electric transportation fleet is really a demonstration of how it can be done in Hong Kong. So this year, we've got speakers from Sweden, the Netherlands, and Hong Kong, as well as panelists from industry, academia, and LegCo. And I'd like to thank them all for coming here today and for sharing their expertise. I'd also like to thank our moderators. We have Lockie Law and Alex Y, both from Charged Hong Kong, who've come here to try to steer the discussions. And finally, last but not least, I'd like to thank all you for coming here today and donating your time. We've got about 250 people here in the audience today, which is double the size of last year. So it's great to see this event grow and continue. A little bit on my organization. So Charged Hong Kong is a local charity. We were formed a little over 4 years ago to support and accelerate the adoption of plug-in electric vehicles in Hong Kong. The title of this conference, Smart City, Smart Mobility, gives us direction to the way we think Hong Kong should progress. Electric vehicles, as an example, cannot operate in an isolated bubble. They require infrastructure support, benefiting from smart charging technologies and smart electricity grids. They operate on our shared transportation networks of roads, railways, and waterways, and they can both be a smart consumer as well as a smart producer of data and information for those networks. And finally, modern electric vehicles are actually nodes on our smart telecommunications networks. With cellular connectivity, they provide telemetry, traffic updates, fleet tracking, and other such functions. So we see a smart city in the near future with smart mobility driven by an API sharing of information. And in recent years, much progress has been made towards that goal. I'll give you some examples. Hong Kong has always had an excellent electricity grid. I mean, really leaders in the region. And we're now seeing the deployment of smart metering systems. We're looking forward to seeing the integration of local electricity generation from renewables such as wind and solar integrating into this emerging smart grid. And this is facilitated by the generous feed-in tariffs that the government's currently offering. For me, it's interesting also how electric vehicles can help with this as batteries connected to this grid, vehicle to grid and other such technologies should help in the future. In recent years, we've seen the highways and transportation departments release more and more of their information electronically. And a number of apps have appeared to make that information available to the public in different ways. Recently, both New World First Bus and City Bus have agreed to open up real-time bus route arrival data, and we really hope that other bus companies and public transportation systems will follow. Another example is how our observatory is publicly releasing summary as well as detailed and historical weather information, and how groups such as the Weather Underground are taking that data, processing, transforming it, and adding their own local observatory data to produce a consolidated view of the weather in Hong Kong. Such information can make transportation safer, both from territory-wide weather events such as typhoons, as well as local events such as rainstorms and flooding. In conclusion, there are certainly concerns which such an open information sharing future can bring. Concerns such as privacy and competitive commercial information. But I know that these can be addressed in a reasonable manner, because we really want to achieve the benefits that an open information sharing system can bring to such a smart city as Hong Kong. We can either choose to lead the way, or we can choose to fall behind our neighboring countries. And I, for one, both hope and work for a future where we lead. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Webb Johnson, for the insights, and Charge Hong Kong for the constant support. Following the opening remarks, we will proceed to have Helena Storm and Magnus Carnwall to discuss urban mobility in Sweden, and also a case study by Mark Van Kerkhoff on sustainable smart city, research innovation in smart cities by Professor John Shi, and two panel discussions with experts from respective areas, before wrapping up the event with a short networking lunch. There will be a Q&A session after each panel discussion, so you are all encouraged to use Slido to ask any questions that you would like. Moving to the first topic of the day, we are privileged to have Helena Storm, Consul General of Sweden in Hong Kong and Macau, Magnus Carnwall, Counselor for Energy Affairs, Embassy of Sweden in Beijing, to share their insights on urban mobility in Sweden. May I now invite them onto the stage.
Good morning, dear ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. It is with great pleasure I address you this morning, and thank you for inviting Sweden to share some thoughts and information on our policies regarding this very important topic, smart city and smart mobility in particular. On this topic, I wanted to share a world news with you. Maybe some of you have already read it in the newspapers, but 5 days ago, the first driverless electric truck was driven on public roads in Sweden. This is a great step, and it's promising for the future regarding smart mobility. But this is one example how Sweden tries to be leading in this respect. I often ask myself, what is a smart city, really? And it's a tricky question, and depending on where you are and whom you talk to, you will probably have different answers. But for me, a smart city is a city that's inclusive, safe, sustainable, and connected. And for a country to become leading in this regard, you need both ambitious public and private actors, as well as ways of cooperation, both at national and international levels. And we must be creative in thinking new ways of cooperating in this respect. From a Swedish perspective, strong political focus for decades has been given to find solutions to ensure high environmental standards and sustainability. We have gone from a classic definition and way of addressing specific problems relating, for example, to the environment, more or less isolated from other policy areas, to a definition seeing them as an integral part of what we call the circular economy, a way of life that does not leave a negative footprint for future generations. Sweden has set a goal to be climate neutral by the year of 2045. In addition to this goal, the Swedish government also calls for a fossil-free society by 2030, and for Sweden to become one of the world's first fossil-free welfare countries with a fossil-free fleet of vehicles. These are ambitious goals, but by taking responsibility for our climate impact at home, we hope to inspire others and to be a model on the world stage. To give you a more comprehensive picture regarding the Swedish efforts towards achieving smart mobility, I am happy to have my colleague Magnus Carnwall, Consular for Energy Affairs from the Embassy of Beijing, here with me today. And once again, I would like to thank you for coming this morning, and I would like to thank Charged Hong Kong and Hotel Icon for organizing this conference and inviting me to share a couple of thoughts on this subject this morning. Thank you. Magnus, I'll leave the floor to you.
Thank you, Helena, and thank you, Hotel Icon and Charged Hong Kong, for inviting us. It's very honored to be here. I'm very honored to be here. I will give you some brief insights of the status of charging infrastructure and e-mobility in Sweden. As Helena mentioned, Sweden aimed to be the first fossil-free welfare state, and ambitious targets are formalized in a climate law. Mobility and accessibility are key factors to achieve this sustainable and inclusive society that we talk about. And today I will touch upon how cooperation and collaboration between stakeholders from business, academia, the public sector, and civil society have enabled Sweden to be a front runner in the transition to a fossil-free society. As a big part of my presentation, I will also touch upon the status of plug-in electric vehicles and the charging infrastructure in Sweden. So, just a very brief glance to Sweden for all of those. Maybe you are very familiar with Sweden, but it's a country in the northern Sweden, not very dense with people, let's say. The population density is just about 22 per square kilometer. Comparing this with China, for example, having 144, it's a big country with not so many people. Thus, we have to be very innovative. So, and that's why maybe we also score quite high on innovation indexes from year to year. For the Swedish climate goals we already touched upon, this framework is one of the most important climate reforms in Sweden's history, and it sets out the implementation of the Paris Agreement in Sweden. So by 2045, as Helena already mentioned, Sweden is to have zero net emissions of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. Pretty high goals, targets that is, and also to reduce the CO2 emissions from domestic transport by 70% in 2030 compared to 2010. I'm coming to China also from my home office, which is the Swedish Energy Agency. So wearing, sometimes I call it, two hats here in China. I'm working for the Swedish Energy in Sweden, which is a governmental agency under the Ministry of Infrastructure. And of course it gives policy support, but also working a lot with different kind of energy statistics. We give forecasts and analysis. We have also a big chunk of research and innovation funding. So we run a lot of research and innovation programs in Sweden, such as battery research programs. And the biggest chunk of our research funding goes, in fact, to the transport sector. We are one of total six transport agencies. We also are a national coordinator since 2015 of the charging infrastructure in Sweden. And also since last year, we have the task of a renewable fuels infrastructure. Just also to give you a glimpse of the energy use in Sweden. Those are numbers from 2017, but still the total final energy consumption in Sweden is, is about 377 terawatt hours. You can see that the fractions divided and the transport sector is covering quite a big piece of this. The transport share has increased since the 80s. It was about 18%. Now we see it's about 23% today. Here we can see on the left-hand side the share of renewables in the road transport. On the right-hand side, we see in the public transport sector. So we have on the x-axis, we can see the share. For the road transport, there has been a significant increase since we see the first 2006 here, going quite climbing a lot to 22% in the road transport. Although we see a dip from last year, that's mainly due to some reclassification on EU level, and also introduction of a bonus malus system, which I will come to talk more about later on. And on the public transport, what I would like to emphasize here is that this picture is especially that the figure of last year for the share of renewables in public transports is already at 93%. So that means that for this indicator, Sweden has already, in fact, met its 2030 goal. And this is largely due to what I call clear governance and cooperation among stakeholders. That's really the key to get there. And one important point to mention is that we very much include this or such targets in when doing procurement criteria. So just now I would like to go further into details about the plug-in vehicle, electric vehicle deployment and the status of charging infrastructure in Sweden. So, there we go. No, it was a lag, sorry. It's not backing. Oh, there we are. So just by, I call it situating the Swedish PEV conditions. PEV, I guess you all are familiar with this, but plug-in electric vehicles. We started off in the 90s with different demonstration sites in different cities around Sweden with battery EVs. We had an early biofuels focus also in the 2000s. A lot of biogas and also ethanol projects to reduce the consumption of petroleum. In 2007, we launched many different research and innovation activities. I mentioned battery programs, etc. In 2011, we introduced the purchase rebate to PEVs. And in 2015, there was a launch of a general investment program and support for charging infrastructure. Comparing this also to other countries with provinces, et cetera, we don't have any local regulatory incentives. We only have national ones. So Sweden has used vehicle taxation in this sense to promote low emission vehicles for many years, and the government considers that to be a very important complement to fuel taxation. The purchase rebate, which I mentioned in 2011 here, it was recently modified. Last year in July, we introduced a bonus malus system, which is sometimes referred to as a fee bait for new light duty vehicles. This, in very short, is vehicles with low CO2 emissions. They qualify for a bonus at purchase. If that's a 100% EV, that could be the maximum amount is 6,000 euros, approximately. Whereas vehicles with high emissions, they are taxed at a higher rate during the first 3 years. So the and this is an overview of how we support PVs on the demand side, not including all the details, of course, but I do apologize for the most text-intensive slide of the day, maybe. But to not go into the very nitty-gritty details, I could have included how we work with regional planning, and we have energy and climate advisors all around the country helping purchasers and others to do the best choice there is. But to touch upon some of the bullets here, I would like to mention that the investment support scheme I already mentioned, called the Climate Leap, will most likely continue until the next election in Sweden, which is going to be held in 2022. That's at least what we hope today. The e-bus purchase rebate, this is for full electric and plug-in hybrids and also fuel cells. Buses. This size of the rebate is depending on who is buying, but in general it's about 20% of the sale price of the procured buses. So, and the last two support schemes was just temporary last year, but still we have new incentives coming up, probably in a similar way. But this is to be finalized in the government. However, the transport sector remains for us and the globe a challenge. Today, it stands for about 23% of the total greenhouse gas emissions in Sweden. And more has to be done, clearly. As an example, in the state budget of 2019, the government increased the budget for urban planning and building with about 40%. Several of those targets are on greening of urban environment and transport. So there's a big emphasis to reach our 2030 goals. Then if we look at some numbers, I don't talk about absolute numbers here, but in the market shares, if we look at PEVs in Sweden, we actually have the largest market share in the EU. We are come on the third place after Norway and Iceland on a global level. It is today or last in 2018, it's about 7%, yes, had to check. But we actually see that the market share in 2019 so far is all the way up to 12 to 13%. So that's very encouraging. We have a big emphasis on plug-in hybrids. So it's a preferred vehicle for customers, obviously. Two-thirds of it, in fact. And just to mention also that we run 150 full electric buses in many cities around Sweden, 18 cities. If we look at the absolute numbers, we have today about just above 80,000 plug-in electric vehicles in Sweden. Then if we look at the Nordic countries, I would like to promote this Nordic EV Outlook that was launched last year. It can be found on the IEA website, but just to mention a few examples from this report. We see one key to the Nordic success, if I may call it like that, is the widespread deployment of block heaters. Being a very cold country, cold Nordic countries, We had already an infrastructure of block heaters, more or less. So we have the electricity all around just to rearrange a bit then we had the charging infrastructure more or less for free, I wouldn't say, but it's easier. And also, as I mentioned before, Sweden prefer PE plug-in hybrids as well as Finland and Iceland do. So just to mention this to you today. One other very important piece of the puzzle is the electricity market in Sweden and how it is designed. So it is, since the 90s, a completely deregulated market. Anyone can become a charging point operator, CPO. So this is also a very interesting way that people can become a stakeholder in this. The home charging is equivalent to other household electricity loads. We have the market price, as I put them in brackets here, but it, for public charging, is more or less up to the owner. Of course, there are some criteria that should be met. It should not be unfair, as we say, and it should be correlating to equivalent amount or cost for conventional fuels when you fuel up. So there's some criteria there, but still, it's a market price. And if we look at the charging behavior, how people like to charge their vehicle, we see that most of Swedes, they charge home. Home charging is really 80 to 95% of the charging is being done at home. We also see this in the investment support scheme from the climate leap I mentioned. About 22,000 home charging points have been granted investment support through this. And this is just for those of you more into the details of charging facilities, a picture showing the different charging types. And clearly, we have, maybe I should mention also on the left-hand side, we have numbers on the lower side is from 2015 to 2018. We see clearly that the EU standard, which is the type 2 being in pink or red here, is the main one together with the Shuko one, so in yellow. So those are the most common ones in Sweden. If we look at the next two slides, they are to show the coverage in Sweden and also to show how big impact this climate leap investment support scheme has had. So if we look at public charging infrastructure, that's below 23 kilowatt AC, that's On the left-hand side, you see the green dots. They're the existing public charging stations. And if you look on the right-hand side, it's the charging stations with support granted through the investment support scheme, Climate Leap. So it's a really a good incentive on the market. If you look at the more or less comparing this to higher charging, 50 kilowatt. What DC, you see more or less the same trend also there. But before running off, I would like to emphasize once more the importance of cooperation and between different stakeholders, how we have worked in Sweden and mention a few examples. We have Stockholm as one, of course, they were early adopter, I would say. They also have this ambitious program to promote PEVs. They have had several information campaigns about home charging. They have now today a very good public charging infrastructure in place, and most of our PEVs are actually in Stockholm, about 50% of our PEV fleet. is in Stockholm. So this could be further dwelt upon and showcased, of course. But I took this opportunity today to give you a more introduction to how it's looking in Sweden in more general terms. If we go to other cities, one more in the northern parts called Östersund, and one in the middle called Gävle, we have two examples where actually the authorities and housing companies and energy providers, they sit together to plan and working towards the same goals. Then we see the results. And also, of course, Gothenburg, down in the southern parts of Sweden, where a public parking company has taken the leadership to facilitate the charging infrastructure deployment. So, but then what's in common here? I already mentioned it. We have first actions that are initiated by some demonstration project, bringing together those stakeholders, sitting at the same table, that gives results. So, just maybe not really to sum up, but to give some outlook and final words from my side, we see that consumers, they are in fact still early adopters, but we also see that the need for a policy-driven deployment, which is in fact needed for both vehicles and the charging infrastructure. There need to be still a strong commitment from the government, and we see new incentives coming up also in the future that has to be done still. I talked a lot about cooperation. We see that social and technological innovation is created in projects where those stakeholders sit together in the same table, around the same table. Just also the electrification is just one piece of the puzzle, as I say. We want to be technology neutral, so we include all those different biofuels and biogas is a big thing in Sweden. Also, if you saw the map of Sweden, it's the most densest in the southern parts of Sweden. We have a lot of bioenergy, a lot of forests, etc., that we can use for many different purposes, not just bioenergy for heating or electricity, but also for biogas from the agriculture and forestry. But we do need to have a systemic approach here, where the transport efficient society is key. So not just looking at one piece of the puzzle at a time, but looking at them in a systemic approach. And that's more or less what I would like to share with you today. I'm happy to try to answer any questions you might have as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cornwall, for sharing your expertise. May I now invite Helena Storm back onto the stage to answer a few questions from the audience, and Mr. Webb Johnson to moderate the Q&A session.
Firstly, thank you for coming and for those really interesting talk. It's interesting, while you were talking about block heaters, I could see the smile on the face of CLP and Tesla thinking if Hong Kong had block heaters in every parking space, things would be much simpler here.
That's for sure.
I think we'll look at some of the questions which come up here. The first one was, what advice does Sweden have for Hong Kong in achieving sustainability and becoming a smart city? I mean, you're on the way. How can we do it?
Well, I would say that I already touched upon it, but not just having one deciding about what to do, but getting everyone around the table. That's the key to work towards the same goal, and that you have a strong policy incentives where to go. If you have a like. I mentioned the climate law from last year or 2 years ago in Sweden. That's a really big push. We have a policy agreement among in the government, all different political parties agreed to have a framework and goal to target. That's really the key. Then you have also the incentives coming along the way for the different stakeholders and do the investment necessary.
Yeah, maybe if I can just add to that, I think what is very important, having been in Hong Kong for 4 years, I think one advice is really, which is very difficult, is not to work in silos. It's so important that the different government bureaus work together on these issues, because in silos it will be very difficult to achieve a smart city, and this is really something we've learned the hard way in Sweden. And I also think, like Magnus said, bold political decisions and visions are really necessary in this field.
Thank you. Yeah, I think in Hong Kong we have a policy direction, but it's very weak. I mean, there's no set goals of when we will achieve certain percentages of electric transportation or sustainability or renewable energy, etc. So certainly that sort of government direction and then the policy backing up. We also have the same problem of many departments, and particularly transportation. Electric transportation brings in electrical mechanical services department, transportation department, the highways department, environmental department, etc. So I see the problem. Okay, so what about, I mean, if we talk about, in Hong Kong we talk about carrot and stick, incentives versus disincentives. And what is Sweden or the Swedish Energy Agency doing to push this transition in the transport sector?
Well, also, once again, doing these different kinds of putting the incentives there, but also the clear goal. I mean, we follow up on how the incentives are working ahead. You saw the pictures of yellow and blue, seeing how the incentives are working, where people are investing, because, of course, it's not 100% rebate or 100% incentive for the customer. It has to be some interest and willingness, but also together trying to reach the same goal. But just referring back to your last question, was also to be specific, to dare to risk setting a goal target year, maybe, as we did in 2030, in 2045. Although now it seems to be a long way ahead, but it's coming on fast. So, but it's still maybe the biggest challenge we have in Sweden to accomplish those targets. So, still a lot to do. Although maybe I showed the nice pictures here, but we really have a lot to do also.
It's
in Sweden.
A long journey.
Yes.
Okay. So how is Sweden, or is Sweden, helping other countries get closer to achieving emission goals in terms of exporting technology, or, you know, apart from coming here today, of course?
Yes, we have, I do personally have a constant and continuous dialogue with the Hong Kong government on these issues, and we do help Swedish companies to export their technology. And but as I said, and Magnus said, there need to be bold political decisions in place. We have, for example, in Singapore, Volvo has just launched its first driverless electric bus on the streets of Singapore. We are ready to do that in Hong Kong as well, if the legal framework would be there. And we also have the truck company of Scania here in Hong Kong, ready to assist. They have state-of-the-art technology also in this. And in that respect, it's important to have bold decisions, such as the Hong Kong government's decision to give a bonus on the scrapping of Euro 3 trucks. And we are following the continuation and hope the decision to also include the bonus for scrapping the trucks on Euro 4 to lessen the road emissions. These are very practical things that and technology that the Swedish companies here in Hong Kong, they have and stand ready to contribute with.
And just to add to that also, that you mentioned before, we shouldn't work in silos. Sweden should not work in silos. We need to be on the market as well to share our knowledge, what has been done. Helena mentioned the public road test there just a few days ago. Of course, that comes in the news as well, but still, we should share our knowledge in that sense. Also, me being in China as an energy counselor, trying to set up some platforms where Swedish stakeholders can integrate or get into collaboration with Chinese and Hong Kong stakeholders. That's the key to get the knowledge out, not just a knowledge transfer as such, but knowledge collaboration. And technology transfer is one key, of course, but not the only solution.
Okay, let's see what else we have. So how is the Swedish government, or what are they doing to support the home charging infrastructure? I mean, you talked about the block heaters and the incentives for that. Is there anything, do you have any issues related to home charging, technologically wise or infrastructure wise? And what can you help?
Well, of course, I mentioned the incentive schemes, the support schemes, which has been proved to work quite well. And I hope we will see those coming soon again. I mentioned it was one scheme was finalized last year, but I think the main. The main thing is to showcase to everyone, not just the economic benefit, but the to link it also to environment, etc. That you are part of this as a customer, coming towards the same goal as not just a government goal, but everyone is involved and getting the person involved in that is very, very fruitful, of course, but also very.
Yeah, no, I think you touch on a very important point here, and you can draw the parallel to environmental. To care about the environment in a more kind of global scale. In Sweden, we've for decades, have campaigns that you should pick garbage in the nature, you recycle at home. 99.3%, I think, of the household waste is recycled because of these kind of efforts to make people part of it. You are part of the global solution, and I think this is really important to establish also when it comes to transport and finding sustainable ways of transport and clean fuel and non-emission, that you become part of the global solution, and that for you it's kind of inconceivable to have a diesel or a petrol car. In the same way as in Sweden, it's just inconceivable that you would throw a plastic bottle in the garbage. You don't do it.
Yeah, I think, politically and socially, you have a social system and people's sense of responsibility and sense of community in Sweden, and the love of the country and the countryside is very impressive whenever I visited there. So you think that having that fundamental social feeling impacts and helps this transition to sustainability and electric transportation?
Yes, definitely.
Yes, we do. It's part of it. It's not the whole solution, of course. There are many, many parts, but it's one part.
But it gives a lot of support from the people as well as from the government.
Exactly.
Strong push, that is.
Okay, I think we're out of time. So thank you so much for coming and for sharing what you guys are doing in Sweden. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
all for sharing your expertise with us. And do not worry if your questions was not answered during this Q&A session. Later on, we will have a coffee break and you can network and ask questions with the experts. Now, may I please invite Mr. Mark Van Kerkhove, Managing Consultant on Energy and Climate for APPM, onto the stage to give us an overview of the Netherlands on sustainable smart city. Please.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for inviting me to this until so far very inspiring conference. My name is Mark van Kerkhove. I'm working as an independent consultancy, but working a lot for the Dutch government in a combination with the Dutch government. So I'm also representing the Dutch government in this presentation over here. So it's not only from my company, it's also from the Dutch government. By my presentation, I'd like to inspire you from the Dutch approach. The Dutch approach is about thinking, but also about just doing it. And one thing I don't want to do is searching the competition between the Netherlands and Sweden, because I think it's not about competition, it's about achieving the goals we want to face worldwide. And we need everything, and we don't need competition. We need all kinds of approaches. So I'm working for APPM, an independent management consultancy firm based in the Netherlands, but also with offices in Belgium, Germany, and California. And we are the thought leaders when it comes to e-mobility and smart charging infrastructure in a lot of countries. Focused on high-end consultancy, policy, strategies, smart charging, smart green-based solutions, and so on. And we work across the EV chain, and we'll go to that later on in my presentation. For the Netherlands, for a lot of countries worldwide, it doesn't start with the Paris agreements. We were already starting when it comes to electric mobility from about 2008, 2009. But the Paris agreements were really important for us because worldwide we set goals. Especially for the Netherlands, really important. When you look to Europe, we are over here. Close to Sweden when you look to distances, when you compare it to China. And it's red. It's red because we got huge amounts of carbon dioxide in this part of Europe, as well as in the Italy, but as well as in the Netherlands, Belgium, parts of Germany, and the London area capital. And we want to go forward to a clean, smart society. So we set up a few goals, and some of these goals had a focus on sustainable mobility. But when you look to sustainable mobility, you need more than only electric cars, electric vehicles, and so on. It's not only about the vehicle, it's about the usage of the vehicle. It's about the behavior of the driver. And it's about model shift, try to get people into public transport or being, think about the way you use transport in a sufficient way. When we look to immobility, and especially when my company looks to immobility, we see this as the combination, as we call it, on a scientific way between the Trias Mobilica and the Trias Energetica. The Trias Mobilica has a focus on three angles: avoid the trip, try to do a model shift, but also looking to a sustainable way of doing your transport. When you look to the Trias Energetica, it's exactly the same, but then when the focus on energy. And when we look to e-mobility, we see in e-mobility these two coming together. The electric car or the electric bus is not only a sustainable way of getting your transport, it's also a sustainable way, or you can use it in a more sustainable energy transition. So Sweden already mentioned, we see e-mobility as well as in transition. It's not binary, it's not there just in one step. You need 20, 30, 40 years. And you have to design your policy with the focus on transition. So maybe two steps forward, one step back, and so on. We have to learn, inspire each other, share knowledge, and so on. Last year, we did a big study for the city of Amsterdam, one of the world leaders when it comes to e-mobility, and we evaluate their policy instruments when it comes to e-mobility. And what we learned with each other is that the policy instruments really differs per transition stage. So, for example, the city of Amsterdam already started about 5 years ago with zero emission taxis. And when you start with that, you have to stimulate that market. You have to stimulate taxi drivers to drive electric. It's not the right moment of time at that moment to regulate that sector and said you are not allowed to enter the city center anymore if you don't have an electric car. It's not possible because the cars weren't there, the drivers weren't possible to drive that car. So first you have to stimulate the sector. And then later on in the time, you can regulate. If there are a lot of cars, then you can regulate and allow taxi drivers only to drive or to enter the city center of Amsterdam to drive electric. And of course you have to facilitate this by putting enough charging infrastructure in the public area. So this is the taxi sector is an example of how you can how you have to defer your policy instrument per stage. So not starting just right away with the stick, as you just mentioned, Mark, but make a combination between stimulate, facilitate, and regulation. And in every step of the stage, you have to be aware of this. So it's not a one-size-fits-all approach. Every stage asks for a different approach in that way. So each kind of transport has another, is at this moment in the Netherlands, in another part of the stage and the transition. So then some numbers. In the Netherlands, there are about, at this moment, about 152,000 electric cars. So that's about 55,000 full electric cars and about 96,000 plug-in hybrids. These are the latest numbers from April 2019. There's a reason for these changes in the numbers, and this reason is taxes. The Dutch government is influencing the number of cars by policy, by taxes for car users. And in the beginning of electric cars, in 2013, you don't pay any tax for a plug-in hybrid car as well as for a full electric car. But then we saw that it's getting expensive. It gets too expensive. And the hybrid cars are racing really fast and it gets too expensive. And on the other end, we see a really increase of the number of affordable full electric cars. So we changed the scheme from an incentive with a broad perspective on full electric and plug-in electric, we changed it into a scheme focused on full electric cars. So at this moment, someone who drives a full electric car pays a small amount of tax, and someone who's driving a plug-in electric car or buying a new full plug-in electric car pays the same amount of taxes as someone who's driving a fossil fuel car. So we really want to decrease the number of plug-in hybrid electric vehicles. And what you see is that there's a slight decrease in the numbers, and that's because of the export. The export of used plug-in electric cars to other European countries, because we got one European economy, it's really easy to export these cars within Europe. Bloomberg presented this slide a few months ago, which is really interesting. It shows that the time to sell 1 million electric vehicles worldwide drops really rapidly. So until 2016, it costs worldwide 60 months to sell 1 million electric vehicles. At this time, it's about 6 months. So it really increased. And I think maybe within a few years, we go to 6 weeks instead of 6 months. The Dutch way of working is focused on a few things. First one, doing it. The second thing, if we want to do, we try to create policy and achievable goals. And the third thing is we do it together. And as last, this doing together is really focused on public agreements, national public agreements with all organizations in the chain involved. So worldwide, it's called the Polder model, or the way of working together with all stakeholders involved. That's really the Dutch approach. So our new government, which is there for at this moment about 2 years, they set a new goal. We want to have 100% new sales, zero emission in 2030. So electric, full electric, or hydrogen. And we don't know exactly when we want to have 100%, but the focus is on 2050. Because cars are driving really long in the Netherlands. The average car is about 16 years old in the Netherlands. So we need from 2030 about 15 till 20 years to have a full electric car park in the Netherlands. But it's not only about the new sales, it's also of cars, but it's also about transit buses. I managed a process with all stakeholders involved, and we agreed that in 2030, every public transit bus will be zero emission. And I think this is a really successful way of working together. What we see is that we got our public transit is working with concessions. A company is getting via competition the possibility to drive a public transit in a city or in a region for 10 years. And nowadays we are able to ask full electric buses in that concession in that region. And nowadays we see that I think we will achieve the 2030 goals more earlier, and maybe in 2028, the public transit in the Netherlands will be zero emission. So it's about cars, it's about buses, but it's also about taxis. When we managed the public agreements for zero emission buses, the next step we made was into the taxi sector. And we thought, I managed the process by myself, we thought that we can face the same goals. So 2030, the taxi sector will be zero emission. But the taxi stakeholders involved, they said to us, no, we want to have it earlier. We want to have 2025, because we need reasonable goals and not a goal which is too far away. So we hope to try to make the taxi sector in the Netherlands zero emission in 2035. Another way of working with the public agreement is city distribution. A lot of cities in the Netherlands want to achieve the goal that in 2025 the city distribution is zero emission, like cars like this, and so on. But for the Netherlands, as being an export economy, it's not only about sustainability, it's also about green growth, as we call it. So for us, it's very important. This slide is a little bit older, but it's very important to create new jobs when it comes to electric mobility. The European headquarters of BYD and Tesla is an example of try to achieve a green growth agenda. But there's more. It's about services, but it's also about hardware. It's about electric buses by VDL. It's about electric charging systems from Heliox. It's about electric transport by Heineken. It's about the biggest electric fleet of taxis in the airport, like the Tesla taxis in Amsterdam. But it's also about charging infrastructure. We really are ahead in the world when it comes to making charging infrastructure, especially when it comes to AC, on an AC level. So the Green Growth Agenda is working with partners in business programs. So there are a lot of partners in business programs between the Netherlands and other countries in the world when it comes to trade, when it comes to exchange knowledge on electric mobility. And especially there's already a long relationship between the US and the Netherlands when it comes to zero emission vehicles. And now there was a letter of intent signed between China, US, and the Netherlands for the so-called ZEV, Zero Emission Vehicles Policy Lab, and especially with the university in Shenzhen. Okay, now we'll focus more on charging infrastructure. This is really a typically Dutch street. Nice houses, people own a car, really expensive houses. I think a house like this will cost about 800,000 euros or 8 million Hong Kong dollar. So expensive. But people don't have the possibility with these expensive cars to park their car on their own area. So they are dependent on the public street. They are dependent on these kind of streets and the more worldwide known Amsterdam canals streets, but we are dependent on public areas. So about 60% of the people in the Netherlands and about 18 million people in the Netherlands live, about 60% of the people is not able to park their car in a public area. So really dense country. So we need public charging. We need charging in parking garages. We need charging in at houses. We need charging in public areas and so on. So we set up a big program when it comes to charging. First, some numbers. At this moment, there are about 22,000 public chargers in Netherlands, so on the street. And there are also about 18,000-19,000 chargers which are accessible, public accessible in parking garages, for example. And then we've got about 1,200-1,300 fast chargers and huge amounts of AC charging stations at people's homes. But we don't count them because there's no availability to count them because it's privately owned. So when it comes to the numbers in the Netherlands, we are the front runner. And it's, I'm a little bit proud being the front runner, but it's not about being the front runner. It's about that if we want to achieve the sustainable and the Paris Agreement goals, we need these huge amounts of charges. We have to invest, otherwise people can't buy an electric car, because they won't buy an electric car because they are not able to charge their car on public streets. So what we did already 5-7 years ago, we create a kind of the Dutch basic principles for charging. And they focus on interoperability, open source, clear roles, and independent supervision. We create a kind of market model, as we called it. And there were different scenarios, but in the end, we choose for the scenario which is based on the banking model. If you go with your bank card to an ATM, which is not of the bank, you have your banking card with behind the screens, the two of them are decalculating the numbers of the money you get from your bank account. It's the same in electric charging in the Netherlands. So you are an e-driver, you get this RFID charging card, you get to the charger, and then you charge, someone's providing the ground for the charger, have a charging point operator, and the charging point operator and the service provider are both of them are making money or trying to calculate the number of kilowatt hours you charged. If we look to the cost of public charging, we see that there, it's about an initial investments and it's about annual costs and income. And what we see in the past is that the initial investments, it's about the hardware, it's about putting the charger in place and so on. These are much more higher than the annual or daily income on the charger. So there's a negative business case on the public charger. And it's really important for us in the Netherlands to have a positive business case on public charges, because otherwise we are subsidizing these public charges until the end of the world. So what we did, we create a few solutions. One of the solutions is decrease the cost of the charger by tenders, competitions, by merging operations, and so on. But we also increase the income, increase the price per kilowatt hour, creating a national fund. But we also create the NKL, a National Knowledge Center for Charging Infrastructure. And nowadays, we are able to make a little bit of money or to have a positive business case when it comes to public charging. So the national as well as a local or regional government doesn't invest any money anymore in public charging. They invest some money in my company to manage the process, but that's all of the costs. And what we see is that in the regions on the right hand of the slide, you see some regions at the eastern part of the Netherlands, and there were recently being tenders done, tenders competitions for public charging, and not the smallest numbers. And we see already for about 10,000 public charges in the Netherlands at this moment that there's a positive business case in these charges. Last week, a competition was ended in the city of Amsterdam for 10,000 public charges. And as well, there was a positive business case. Well, what we see in the Netherlands is that what we do is that when it comes to policy making, it has to be, you have to be, have to discuss with the local or the regional government what they want to do, how much influence they want to have on charging, on the price, for example, or how much influence they want to have on the costs. And it really depends on the situation, but what we see is that there are three kinds of situations, and especially the situation in the middle, the concession model, where private organization get the permit and the duty to install and operate charging station in a certain area, is really popular and is the way of working in the Netherlands. So what we see is that by a competition, one organization is selected to install 5, 6, maybe 10,000 public charges in a certain area for 2 till 4 years. It really depends on the local situation. And this organization has the possibility to operate another 4 till 6 years these same chargers. So we create competition, and what we see is that price is a competitive advantage in these. So small insights in the business case. So here are 10 years, the first 3 years is the investment install period. So an operator has to make a lot of money because he has to invest in the chargers. But later on, the chargers are there and the income period starts. And what you see in this example is that the business case at the end is positive. So what we see is that there's no government money has to be involved anymore. And what we see is that there's a kind of local charging evolution. When we started with charging in the Netherlands, especially public charging, we started with what we called the strategic locations approach. We put chargers in front of town halls, in front of train stations, and so on. But there's no one's charging their car 8 hours in front of a town hall. No one is visiting a town hall for about 8 years. But it was necessary to show that public charging and electric mobility is possible. So we make the next step, and we call it the demand-driven approach. So we have we place chargers there where there's a demand for chargers, a demand from someone who owns or drives electric car, and we try to get a charger as close to their home as possible. But, for example, if someone is in a 300 meter, there's already a charger. We try to use two users use the same charger. And nowadays, we are at a data-driven approach, as we call it. We got so much data about where people charge, where from mobile data providers, we got data about where people drive and so on. So we make the next step, and we call it a data-driven approach. So nowadays, we know exactly where the electric driver of the future will live. And via the concession in the center of the Netherlands, in the city of Utrecht, we try to set up a competition with this data-driven approach. So we already ask the contractor of the concession to already put chargers there where there's a demand in the future. So when it comes to charging, we see these kind of, we call it the charging pyramid. You first start with the development of a charging network, then you create technical aspects like specification protocols, and then the next step is about smart charging. Smart charging, I will go to that later on. But what we see is that we have to be aware of a big change in electromobility, but also a big change when it comes to public charges. And the next step in the Netherlands is that we calculated that approximately, if we want to achieve our goals, we approximately have to install somewhere between 500 and 1,000 chargers every day. It's not only public chargers, it's also in parking lots, it's also people's homes, but we really need, we got the challenge, let's say it that way. On the other end, we see that, and then I come to the energy transition, that we see that there's a big ask when it comes to, a big demand when it comes to electric cars for energy. But you can also see it as an opportunity. When we got about 2.8 million or somewhere between 2.5 and 3 million electric vehicles in 2030, it's the same amount as 8,000 soccer fields of solar, or 27 million solar panels, or it's the same as 840 high wind turbines. And this is when all 2.8 million vehicles start charging at the same time, the same day, the same moment. And we don't want that. So our really focus is on smart charging. Smart charging in time, but also on vehicle-to-grid solutions. And we also already have some showcases with vehicle-to-grid, but we have about, I think, all new chargers in the Netherlands already have the possibility for smart charging. So charging when there's wind, or when there's solar, charging when it's the best for the energy grid. And at the end, I believe, and this, I'm hereby coming at the end of my presentation, it's about sustainability, and it's not only about sustainability, it's about a happy, smart society. So that's why I want to ask this with a positive point of view. We have to make the step forward, and we have big challenges, but I think there will be a new economy, there will be a new way of working, and I'm sure we'll make it in the Netherlands. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Van Kerkhoff, for sharing your expertise with us. Now may I invite Mr. Webb Johnson onto the stage to ask some questions from the audience. Thank you.
Thank you, that was very interesting.
You're welcome.
I particularly found it fascinating the way you address the charging infrastructure first before you talk about the arrival of the vehicles, etc., or you address the taxi infrastructure first before you talk about forcing or asking taxi drivers to drive electric vehicles. It's obviously a very long-term view. It's, if you build it, they will come. how has that worked out? Has it been successful in your view? Has it been, looking back at it, was that the best way of doing it?
You mean especially the taxis or this way of working?
In general.
Right? In general. There'll be some challenges. I think we got politicians with a point of view for a maximum of 4 years. So, and you need a long-term policy in this case. So that's a challenge. On the other side, I see that, especially on a local and a regional level, there's the real leadership. And you see the growth and the leadership in cities is really something which is growing and growing. So what we see especially in Amsterdam is a big example, but Rotterdam as well, and other regions and cities in the Netherlands, that the real leadership is on a local and a regional level. But in one way, you're depend on tax policy, and the tax policy is on a national level. What I think is that in 2025, we think in the Netherlands in 2025, an electric car is able to compete with a gasoline car. When it comes to total cost of ownership and things so on, when you put all taxes away. So if you got flat fee or flat way of thinking, we see that in 2025 it can compete. And I think until that, we have to be aware that we need these tax policies. And it's about 5 to 6 years, and I think we can make it. And then we have till 2025 to create a good charging infrastructure, to create policies to make the next step towards 2030. So I'm positive, but we still got some challenges when it comes to taxes, when it comes to multi-home units, apartment buildings, and so on. So we're not there yet.
Yeah, on taxis in particular, I mean, you mentioned them. And you've had a lot of success with the taxi adoption. Across the border, Samjan, there's been government policies basically forcing the use of electricity or forcing the migration to electric taxis. And we've gone through forcing the migration to electric buses already. Hong Kong has not had much success with electric taxis. How have you succeeded in the Netherlands?
A few things. I think we succeeded by setting up some pilot projects to show that it's possible. It's possible in price, it's possible in range, and so on. Another thing, we had a little bit of luck because Schiphol Airport is the only Amsterdam Schiphol Airport is the only Schiphol or area in the Netherlands where taxi companies have to pay when they want to pick up tourists or people who arrive over there. And then we set up a policy that if you want to get a permit to pick up people, it has to be electric. And there was a big change. What was interesting is that when we did this competition, we thought it would be the majority of the people or the companies won't be able to make electric cars, but every competitor had a proposal with electric cars. So the competition was not about electric cars anymore, it was about price. And another thing we do is that, and that's about strong leadership in the cities, that we said, yeah, if you want to go with your taxi in the city of Amsterdam in 2020, for example, you have to be electric. And so we create a stick, but in combination with a small carrot, and that's exactly where the slides comes in with these two, with this figure, with stimulate and regulate. You have to be have a competition of a competition between the two of them.
Yes. What do you think is the biggest challenge Netherlands has had in achieving these goals or getting on the way to achieving these goals?
I think the biggest challenge at this moment is the second-hand car market. So It's very common in the Netherlands that if you are a businessman that you get a company car. But what we see is that people who drive a car private don't buy new cars. They buy second-hand cars. So that's really a possibility for the future, that the company cars will be the second-hand car of a family for the future. But on the other end, we see that the company car is, when it gets second-hand, when it gets out of the contract, it's too expensive for a second-hand car or for a family who wants to drive electric. And that's a big challenge, because the challenge is that the company car, which is electric, is already subsidized by taxes by the government. And if you want to have a positive business case or an affordable electric car for a family, the price has to decrease. And if you want to decrease the price, you can do two things: or you wait till the market is big and then the price will drop. Another thing you can do is that you subsidize this, but then you subsidize the car twice. So that's the big challenge at this moment in the Netherlands. And what we see at this moment is that there's a big increase of electric cars, especially for business people, like the Tesla Model 3 is really coming up in the Netherlands. And we expect that if we wait another 3 to 4 years, then there's so much cars getting out of their lease contract that there's a huge market for affordable second-hand cars for families. So that's, but then the policy comes in. We hope that politicians accept that we have to wait. We don't have to stop making policy, but we have to wait a few years, and then the big market is coming in the second-hand market.
I think the next question I see is, the question itself is talking about the technology changing from the charging infrastructure point of view. And is that a concern for people providing charging, public charging solutions? But I think it also touches on your last answer regarding the second-hand market. I mean, the technology of electric vehicles is progressing so fast that it becomes attractive to buy a new one rather than an out-of-date second-hand one. What do you feel about that?
No, I'm not agree with that. I think that I think that the new electric cars which are getting on the market at this moment are so interesting and have so much technology and are so worldwide driving that when you look to the Netherlands, a lot of people are used to buy a car of 5 to 8 years old for their family. So if it's not about the old technology, it's about the range, and the cars who are getting onto the market at this moment are really having a big range. And in the Netherlands, it's enough when you have about 250 kilometers range, and a lot of new cars on the market have about 250 kilometers at least. So I think and the battery doesn't decrease that much. So I think within 4 or 5 years, it's still about 250 kilometers. So really interesting for that market, I think.
What about on the EV charging side? Is there any concern from the charging providers as technology changes?
There's some concern. The concern is not about that they have old technology. The concern is more that we as consultants and the government are asking in these competition situations every time more innovation. And they're a little bit done with all these innovations. But on the other end, if we don't put in these innovations, we don't are that interesting that I can present the Netherlands over here. So we need these innovations. What I forgot to tell is, for example, that in the northern part of the Netherlands, we have this a competition for a concession. And what we did there is that we separated the contract for the charging and the contract for the energy. So you are able to, if you have solar on your roof at home, you're able to take your own energy to another place where you can charge your car at that moment with your own generated energy. So that's a kind of innovation. We try to succeed, and every next competition situation we try to make it higher and higher. But they don't like it, because they want to have a scheme which is there for about 10 years or something. So,
okay, that's wonderful. Thank you so much for coming.
You're
and
welcome.
For sharing with us.
Okay, thank you.
thank you, Mr. Van Kerkhove, on sharing on how the Netherlands plan on making a stronger relationship between smart mobility and smart energy. Now we will go on to our first panel discussion of the day. It will take a look at the potential of smart mobility in Hong Kong. And don't worry if your questions were not answered during the last discussion. We will have a coffee break after this, where you can network and speak to the experts about the questions. Now, without further ado, may I now invite our panelists, Edmund Chan, Senior Systems Engineering Manager of Technical Services, CLP Power Hong Kong, Honorary Kenneth Leung, Leg Co, Professor Kevin Chu, Associate Professor, Clemson University, Isabel Fan, Regional Director of Tesla, and the moderator of the panel, Dr. Lockie Law, Director of Education, Charge Hong Kong. Thank you, and please have a seat. I miss it. I know you can't forget all the times that we had. Cause I didn't. And baby, sometimes I think about you late now and I wish you more. Baby, sometimes I know you think about me when you're with someone.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Good morning to our speakers. Thank you very much for coming. And this is going to be a very exciting panel because I have prepared some very sharp questions for them. Yeah. So let's begin. So first question is, our panel is titled Unleashing the Potential of Smart Mobility in Hong Kong. So I would like to ask our speakers, how big is Hong Kong's potential of smart mobility? Anybody?
Well, in a nutshell, I think we are a very densely populated city, 7.2 million, clustered over 1,000 square kilometers. I think in terms of connectivity, in terms of, using, electric, people carry this type of, mode of transportation, we got a very big potential, but unfortunately, we even haven't seen the government, putting efforts in putting together a regulatory framework for different modes of transportation, like the e-bike or the electric, individual transportation or the e-skateboarders. These modes of transportation at the moment is still, they're still illegal in the city.
I can say something. I'm living half time in the U.S. and half time in here. So the infrastructure is very different, and it's more kind of rural areas in when I back in Clemson where I live, and here is much more dense area, just like Kenneth just said. But then in terms of policy, I think it's quite initially I think we had a pretty good start, at least in terms of I have to declare that I'm an EV driver as well, okay? The government, initially, they did something great in terms of trying to provide incentive for people to purchase EV, and they set some target, but then they try to provide the necessary infrastructure and various car parks and so on, but then I don't know whether it's change in leadership or what, but then after a few years, nothing is following up, and then they set a target, they never try to evaluate whether they're on the right track and so on. So I think I agree with Canada, we do have a lot of potential. Because at least to me, because Hong Kong people are quite willing to adapt new stuff. At the same time, we got challenges as well. I'll give you an example. My own experience in terms of driving EV and having the relevant infrastructures and so on. In the US, people live in big houses, so charging at home is convenient. But then on the other hand, most people need to drive more longer distance so that the range, we need to charge more often. So we need to have a network of charger. But then in here, people drive shorter distance and in my case, I was lucky enough to install my own charger at home, but for most people, they may not have their own car park and so on. So I think we have the physically the environment is good for that, to develop that, but then I think we do need and we've seen that just relying on the market, it's not fast enough compared with those two countries example that we saw earlier. And give you some number, I think right now the fraction of EV in Hong Kong is less than 2%. It's still relatively low compared with the target initially set by the government. I'm not saying EV is the only way to make the city more smart, but then it's a really good way because of, I remember a little while ago, Elon Musk said that any other cars, I don't have a Tesla, okay, but then I like that guy. He said every car in 3 years, they're like owning a horse, something like that. So these new companies, they're really doing great stuff in terms of helping, not just the car in itself, but then the, how cars are connected and so on. I think we need a little bit of push from the government to achieve that goal if this is what we agree to achieve.
Thank you, Kevin. I think you opened up a very good point for Edmund and also Isabel to pick up as well, because you know on Elon, obviously, Isabel will have to answer you. And then on home charging, we have Edmund. So anybody like to pick up on Kevin's point?
On home charging? I just want to actually answer potential smart.
Sure. Doesn't have to
city
be Elon,
smart yeah. mobility potential. Hong Kong is a very congested city with a limited land, three-dimensional, and actually it's very important to make the city, e-mobility is very important. I personally see enormous opportunity. There's many areas we can improve. We talked about charging a lot this morning so far. Smart charging infrastructure, smart parking. Parking is a challenge in Hong Kong. So it's not only about the hardware, it's not only about the EV, it's about the hardware and software integration. So it's a digitalization, how we move this forward. Hong Kong, together, you know, alongside with China, we actually, it's a technology hub. We have many talents and innovation from this region. And I can see, you know, that it provides a direction or strategy like this for a city like Hong Kong. It provides opportunity for developers, EV operators, EV providers, charging infrastructure operators. So, straight to the point, I see enormous opportunity.
And here comes Edmund, so power.
Yep. So, I think EV, Mark mentioned when everybody charging at the same time could impact our supply network. But actually, we see it as a friend because with smart technology, EV, we can, you have smart charging, V2G, all this technology actually enhance the resilience of our power grid, because when we don't have enough power, actually the EV can, through V2G, give power back to the utility, to the power network. Actually, it works both ways. And we scheduling smart charging, we schedule all the charging at our non-peak period. Actually, we have ample of capacity without significantly to upgrade our system. We can still sustain a lot of charging during our non-peak hours. So it's a lot of potential, and it's good for the community as well.
Sounds very, very hopeful, and also very high tech. So we'll go deeper into that a little bit later. Let's start with the public transport, right? So real-time traffic information from public transport can be very useful for trip planning and easing traffic congestion. And I suppose everybody hates the traffic congestion problem in Hong Kong. However, it has not been easy to obtain these information, real-time information. So what can we do, and what are the alternatives?
Well, I think there's a lack of dialogue between, first of all, government bureau, and secondly, there's also a lack of dialogue between the private sector and the government. Now, if you want a really comprehensive real-time traffic information, what I envisage is not that we need, once we're in the car, we're driving, we have to look at the apps to look at traffic situation. It's terrible. I think what we need is a Now, we got the GPS in our cars. We want some warning, some automatic crop up, you know, software, which will warn you when you were driving the road, okay, 2 miles ahead you got, you know, traffic jam, or, you know, another, when you turn around the corner, that will be, there's a traffic accident, and don't avoid that. This kind of really automatic signaling to the driver or the user of road. Of course, I mean, if you're not driver, if you are a pedestrian or walking in the street, perhaps we should need more of these smart lampposts telling you, for example, the air pollution index, where's your the nearest, you know, public toilet, things like that. Or when you drive past a parking space, on your GPS screen, you probably should have these information crop up. We got another 25 space in this car park, five of which are electric, you know, for electric vehicles, things like that. I don't want to tap into my mobile phone every time I come across to, oh, this is the whatever car park, and then I have to tap into a different application to obtain the information. This is ridiculous, I think.
I think that's very true. Then to be the devil's advocate, it's always saying we have Google. So we can always ask anything from Google. Do you agree?
I'm using Google Map. I'm still using it. and so that's one way. I think the government, I watched a documentary a little while ago, and then according to that interview, and then the government is trying to do to collect data, but then they said, well, buying from Google is too expensive. That's why they work with some university and develop their own system to try to get the data. That's one way to go, but then I think there's a trade-off in terms of Google is a very smart company, and then they're doing things really quick, and they keep updating, getting things better, but then they're not perfect. I mean, I think the government needs to think, have a more clear mind what they're trying to get, and on any hand, they can try to get information from buses. A taxi is another possibility. I mean, because there's always a tension between privacy and get the data, share the data with people. So I think that they at least should be aware of how useful these data potential can be. And I mean, because I'm not complaining, but I know that the government did some project and then try to use those information to, I mean, whenever you cross the tunnel and then they tell you that, you from crossing this tunnel, it takes 20 minutes or something, they're not very accurate usually. So I think there are rooms for improvement in that regard. And I totally agree with kind of in terms of the park, the charging thing. I once in a while I need to charge, even though I have a personal charging station at home, but then the range sometimes for my car, I need to charge outside as well. And it's very inconvenient because for most charging station right now, it's usually inside a parking lot, and then there might be just a few of them, and then they don't even have a sign outside whether it's taken or not. And the apps is still not very much well developed, so that it's very easy, you can tell that where you should go to book a make a reservation, not very convenient at this point. So that's another thing. All these things can be made smarter. And also for my own home charging station, I think for CLP, developing a smart meter, and then so that telling users that what time is cheaper, that people respond to monetary incentive. And most people respond not just to monetary incentive because the money is not a big deal for the low cost in Hong Kong, but then if they know that this is good for the environment, you're charging here, then there's extra capacity, then you should do that. I think that's going to help people to economize in terms of helping the environment as well.
Thank you. Should we move on to the next question? Okay. Next question is on traffic management, basically building on the last one. Singapore is the first city in the world to implement an electronic road pricing, ERP, system in September 1998. So the ERP pilot scheme is central for Hong Kong, right? I would like to ask the speaker, yes or no?
Uh, on them.
That's a no from everybody, is it?
Let me have a go on electronic. Sure, sure. Well, let me have a go on this. I think Hong Kong did have at least part of studies of the electronic road pricing system. We did it at least twice before, once in the 1980s, once in the 1990s. And I think this time, hopefully, we can be more serious because we got a lot of inertia from society. In Hong Kong, I think inertia from the general public is one thing we cannot move faster than other cities in the world. Talk about, you know, electric taxi, we got LPG taxis. Talk about minibuses, we got LPG minibuses, which will be faded out. And I was told by the government the minibuses will, once the current model has expired, they're going to replace it by Euro 6 and not electric ones because we could not find the right model. Come on, guys, please, you know, give me some good models. We got to have a worldwide tendering for our minibuses. But electronic road pricing system, I think in Hong Kong, it will work. It will, of course, it creates revenue. It can ease the congestion. And of course, by easing congestion, you improve the roadside air quality. And by improving the roadside air quality, you reduce your health bill. Now, because in accordance with a study did in 2016 by Hong Kong U, I think the average annual medical bill for disease caused by bad air amounts to about 21.6 billion Hong Kong dollars. And premature death each year because of the bad quality of air is about 1,600 people. It is a very high social cost. So electronic road pricing, for, I think in Hong Kong, I think it does have a really good social benefit apart from generating some revenue for an revenue department.
Thank you. So Kenneth has brought up a lot of relevant points, like on air pollution, on the availability of mini electric minibuses. So we definitely can learn a lot from the Swedens and case studies, right? They have, you know, electric buses, and there's no reason why Tesla cannot produce an electric bus some days, right? Sure, thank you. Okay. Then let's move on to the next question on electric vehicles now, because Kenneth has started that one really well. Electric vehicles play an important role in smart mobility. So what are the advantages of electric vehicles? Also known as, like, why are electric vehicles smart? And in what ways do EVs fit in the context of smart city? So I suppose that will start with Isabel. Right.
So for Tesla, I think currently we still are the most connected vehicle on the market. And we develop not only pure EV, smart EV, with lots of intelligence. It is actually, it is actually very important, I think, as part of the smart city, smart mobility, for EV to drive forward. In the past decade or so, the technology has evolved a lot. When I first joined the community about 5 years ago, the technology is not many choices on the market. The technology is not as matured overall in the market. The range is a problem. Battery life is a problem. Charging infrastructure is a limitation. As of today, Hong Kong we haven't done enough, but it is already have shown some of the success due to enormous effort from the industry, among the community, also supported by the government. So in the past decade, we have done a longer range, right? The overall industry, the EV technology has longer range, long battery life, continue to expand on the infrastructure. And this is the direction, not only from the government, we have to praise on the government's effort moving, having the right approach. They announced a few months ago for that 1,000 charging, public charging infrastructure. It's towards the right direction. This is why I think every little step we have made in the past few years, it's geared towards that sustainable future. So I see, I'm really actually, as my big boss, Elon, Tesla Inc. This is not to dominate, right? We are a frontier technology leader in this area. We want to set example. We want to change the industry. Hope every car maker will make a new energy car, right? To support the environment, support the future. So I think this is the direction. And it's not, as Kevin said, we're only, EV is about 2% of the worldwide. Hong Kong's 2%. Worldwide 0.2% of the overall fleet on the road. So it's too soon to say, when is the tipping point for EV development, right? You barely scratched the surface. There's so much opportunity for the business sector, so much need to be addressed for the future. So I think it's inevitable. It's going to be a continuous development.
Thank you. So again, playing the devil's advocate, say I actually own an electric vehicle, but then let's say I have a fossil fuel car, and I love fossil fuel car. So why can't a fossil fuel vehicle be smart? Why is it only EVs? I mean, obviously EVs is very smart. You have a lot of technology inside, but why can't a fossil fuel vehicle be smart then?
I want to answer a question. So I think in theory it's possible, but in practice we observe that that's not happening. I mean, there is happening, but that usually they're not. I mean, there's economics, this notion of creative destruction. So usually the incumbent, for some reasons, they're more comfortable. So we need some new guy to come in and then disrupt the market. And then once they enter the market, and then the gasoline car, the old brand, they're trying to catch up and then be smarter as well. And so I think that kind of competition is quite useful. So that's one thing, that gasoline car can be smarter, and they are. They're getting better. But that's one point. But then on the other hand, I think EV has an advantage because they can kind of work with the power company, so that the source of fuel, I mean, can have a smarter way to charge up the car. That's something gasoline car can compete with. I mean, we know that EV is good because roadside emission, zero roadside emission. But then at the end, in terms of carbon emission, that depends on how electricity is generated. Okay,
so you keep throwing the ball to
right. But then they have the flexibility. The more clean the way we generate electricity, then the more we can take advantage. So that you kind of work with the EV can take advantage of that. And electricity generation is a very complicated business. So there's peak low thing, and then the demand management, all kind of stuff that we have an expert here.
That's another ball you throw just
right. But then that's create opportunity that we can the traditional way. Not the most effective way, but then with the battery thing, we can store electricity. Storage of electricity is always a big challenge. And I think these EV company, again, Tesla, they're doing great stuff in terms of not just EV in itself, but then the second life of the battery, and then how you can store electricity. That work together, and that can make the city really smart.
Thank you, Kevin. Let's pick Evan's brain now.
Yeah, I think the new generation, the smart mobility, the vehicle itself, I think it is a four key attributes we'll be using. The one is connected, one is autonomous, and shared, and electric is also the key. Because we're sitting here, what energy you are easily accessible is electricity, not fuel. Because you need to go to a petrol station to get your fuel, but electricity you can basically access it everywhere. So it's it's in line with the smart mobility. Though you just when you're smart, you get your energy everywhere. So it actually the infrastructure is easier to put in as compared with petrol station or even hydrogen, things like that. So as with that, and also if you buy a fossil fuel ICE vehicle now, actually your emission actually increase as you're driving it because you get aging and then. But actually if you buy an EV, your emission is improving all the time. The reason is because our generation, the fuel mix is getting cleaner and cleaner. So this is a good for the environment as well.
I am completely sold. I'm going to get EV. No. Oh, well, I already have. Sorry, I forgot about that. Okay, thank you. Thank you, speakers. Next question, autonomous vehicles. So Singapore aims to put self-driving vehicles on public road in 2022. Now, they established a set of professional standards called the Technical Reference 68, TR68, and to promote safe deployment of fully autonomous vehicles. Now, meanwhile, in Hong Kong's West Kowloon Cultural District, the LiDAR-based Nayar Armor test run will end in 2022, same year, basically. So autonomous vehicles for Hong Kong, yes or no?
Well, for one thing, I have to stress that I think we have to overcome the inertia. I think autonomous taxi is a very good thing, but even persuading our taxi driver to accept credit card or other form of cashless payment takes a decade. Now, talking about autonomous, you know, taxis or other vehicles, yes, it's a good idea, but I think we should expand this experimental ground. For example, if we are talking about, for example, transportation within a campus, a university campus. I mean, you can all use that because the routes are really scheduled and you can't detour too much, I mean, in those campuses. So apart from the West Kowloon, I think we can use more the auto driving in these campuses. And at a later stage, we can expand to those, you know, public transport routes where you got really scheduled, you know, routes. But of course, at the end of the day, I don't know, maybe we're all dead in 40, 50 years' time, then we got every vehicle is an auto-driven vehicle. But that would take a bit of time. Even the legislation will be quite, you know, time consuming. How do you regulate an auto drive, you know, vehicle on the road? Who will bear the responsibility for the damages, liability, whether civil or criminal, that kind of thing? I don't know whether Singapore has even come up with a code of, you know, regulation or law to tackle these thorny issues.
Isabel.
So for full self-driving technologies, the technology will be ready before policies. That's for sure.
That's this
year. And for Tesla, we invest lots in R&D for full self-driving technologies, and it will be ready in the near future. And before you know it, it will be ready. And even as of today, our cars on the road, they are hardware ready for full self-driving. 8 cameras, 12 ultrasonic sensor around the body. You can see 450 meters. And it's in a bubble. When the full self-driving software ready, then we will be, if the country has the policy support, we'll be over the air to those vehicles. So that the hardware itself is ready today. Mm. And this is a direction. You know, if the technology can be better leveraged, not everybody need to own a car. With the situation in Hong Kong, congestion could be one of the solutions to ease the congestion. So I think whether Hong Kong will be or not, it requires government, industry, community to work together to make it possible. But I always have to say, this is a hard one. Every country is different, every city is different, So different countries have different challenges, require some time. Yeah.
So I think so one of the difficulty is producing that reliable data that the government will accept. So I think in academia, definitely you have some research and data to provide.
Yeah, and there are pilot studies and so on. But I think I want to elaborate the point that the safety and the congestions in particular, because a lot of time in Hong Kong, the congestion is created by a car accident. Okay, and a lot of time, I mean, don't get me wrong, I enjoy driving, I think I'm a good driver, but still, I mean, there are car accidents every day, and lost lives, and also not less important is the traffic time, because whenever there's some highway, get a car accident, and it just blocks the road, and it's just waste a lot of time, and I think researchers should do the study and kind of collaborate how safe driverless car compared with human. I mean, people are trying to argue that the car company trying to argue that they're much safer, and I think that's true. I mean, because a lot of drivers, for one reason or another, they're not just very very careful and so on. So I think the government should kind of see the trade-off. I mean, it's a new thing, so they might not be perfect with initially is being available, but then they should see the trade-off that human drivers, they're not perfect either, they're far from perfect. So they need to kind of make a cost and benefit analysis to kind of see to what extent we can save people's time and people's life when we kind of push to this frontier. And we can wait and get more data and behind the rest of the world and make sure that it's super safe and then try it, or we can try to be pioneer in terms of learn together how to make things better.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think that actually picks up very well from Kenneth's point, right? Because to get data, we need to have pilot tests, yeah. Pilot studies, and then we can do it in on campus, university campus, which is what Singapore's NUS is doing. In Hong Kong, playing the devil's advocate again, it's our students' lives. So Hong Kong is special. So we can't do it. What do you think, Kenneth? It's like just pick up on the one more point again.
So my permanent job is in the U.S., but then I've been teaching in Chinese University, Hong Kong University, XKUST, I mean, all these universities. I think places like CHK is a good place to start. Anyone from CHK?
Professor Sylvia He, right?
So there are buses and there are cars driving. I think it's a great way to start, and I think there are people I taught in PolyU as well before. It's less convenient because it's not like within the campus, a big campus with cars and so on. But there are other maybe HKUST is another great place that within the campus some people drive within the campus.
Do we need new law for that?
Well, I think as long as the vehicle carries people, passengers on it, I think that the law needs to be changed. That is one thing. I mean, no matter whether you are driving in a campus or you're driving on a highway or public road, that doesn't matter. As long as there's passengers on that vehicle, then you need to change the law.
We rely on you on that.
Thank you. Probably CLP may help. I visit to some of their plans, and then their cars, the big plans that they can experiment within the plan, probably.
As a big slam on his face, Edmund. Edmund, so this exactly the same question is actually related. So what can we expect to see in smart mobility in the next 10 years? So that's part of the question as well.
Yeah, I think with the all the technology improving all the time, batteries, self-driving, everything, I think we're looking to the exciting next 10 years, because in the past 10 years, we see the major development start to come up. I think with all the price, basically price is quite important. I think if the price level currently is really encouraging a lot of people to change to electric vehicle. And together with a lot of the smart features, e-mobility as a service, things like that, I think is quite exciting.
CLP has a few new innovative projects, right? Would you mind sharing one or two?
Yeah, I think I mentioned we are looking at V2G, V2Home, vehicle to home, things like that. It's it's a smart grid, part of smart grid. So we are looking at such future looking technology. So to be ready for the when mobility, smart mobility, electric mobility will be a major percentage in Hong Kong.
Thank you. And then you just follow that order. Kenneth, what about Hong Kong in the next 10 years?
Next 10 years, I wish, I mean, half of the vehicles on the road will be electric by in 10 years' time.
Yes, please.
Yes, and then I wish the price of those vehicles will come down. And I hope there'll be more models to choose from, and brands as well. And more charging, places, you know, it's pathetic. I think even if the government talks about 1,000, it's too few, I think.
Academia.
I think all can set targets and in terms of the fraction of EV and so on, but then I think we should always remember the reason for doing that. I think at the end is we want to have a smart environment so that people can save time, have a more sustainable environment and so on. And the government should have a clear goal in terms of what we're trying to achieve, and then based on those things, and then set those targets to try to replicate those results, and also help educate people that why these new stuff are great stuff that to help us achieve that goal.
Thank you. And lastly, Isabel.
Yeah. So more EV choices.
From Tesla.
Yes, of course. Yeah, and then I think that we don't need to wait 10 years for the EV price to come down at the sweet spot. I think it's coming soon.
Thank you very much.
So the other thing is that next 10 years, other than EV, the infrastructure, right? So I mentioned smart charging, smart payment, smart parking. Those are the things have to happen in the next few years. On the other hand, the public transport solutions. So hopefully, from the private sector, we're getting more mature technologies in the near future. Hopefully, we see more products, EV products in the buses, minibuses, etc.
Thank you very much to all our speakers for the time and sharing. And I think we are moving to the Q&A session. Okay, so Q&A session. First question, for Hong Kong, what should we focus on first? Electric public transport, electric taxis, or electric private cars? Anyone?
Well,
to be fair, I think to the government, I think they got a policy, a transport policy of relying on public transport first. And then, in fact, I think a very high percentage of our public transport in terms of passengers carried is, electric public transport, our MTRC, our three or four different railways already there. And talking about private cars, I do not think there is an underlying policy for the government to encourage the growth of private cars, although it's unstated, it's policy. Of course, I really would like to see the LPG taxis to become electric taxis. That's one thing, because LPG cannot, sustain in the future, because I do not think many of the producers today will continue to produce LPG commercial vehicles. And I think electric taxi will be the way to go. I mean, across the border, we already seen a lot of electric taxis, but why not here?
Thank you, Kenneth. I think I'll go to the third question first. So in terms of land spaces, right, so is one of the biggest challenges in Hong Kong for setting up the EV public charging stations and infrastructures. So I think this question is for Edmund. So how can Hong Kong overcome this without space?
So this will put, the public charging will be a key, because I'm not sure if everybody knows, in the market now there's a called high power charging. So with 15 minutes of charging, you can gain 400 kilometers of additional range. So with this, everybody just like go to petrol station, stay for 15 minutes, and you have enough range for the rest of the week. So this kind of infrastructure will help the space issue.
Did I just hear petrol station with charging facilities?
Actually, around the world, there is Shell. I think they already have a new policy, have building a charging infrastructure within their petrol station.
In Hong Kong?
No, not in Hong Kong. Not yet. should I say.
Okay, thank you. What about
the other area is the car must park somewhere. So where you park the longest, at home or at your office, those areas need to be charging enabled. So this is the key. Currently in Hong Kong, we still need to find a solution to address these needs. For many commercial and the residential buildings, there's an EV user willing to install, but right to install is a problem. So I think this area need to look into.
Okay. Right. I think I'll go to the third question again. So linking the case studies from Sweden and Netherlands, what kind of lesson can Hong Kong learn from them? Anybody? Yeah. Now, Kevin?
I think having a consistent policy as a vision, and then I mean, I'm all totally open to public consultation and so on, but then once we agree as a society, agree what to do, and then the government should have a commitment that oh, you set a target, whatever the target is that the society agreed on, and then try to meet that target. If not, try to reevaluate what went wrong, and then how we should do that. And I mean, we've seen a lot of tax incentives and so on, and how publicly provide some relevant infrastructures, and through taxis, I mean, those are regulated sector, then collaboration between private sector and public sector, and things just mentioned, probably the government may need to communicate with the real estate developer so that when they have shopping mall and so on, whether they need provide them incentive to install those chargers and so on. So, but then the first thing is to have a society to agree what we want to do, and then have a timeline, and then follow that.
Well, so good approach to exert pressure to government, kind of. What's the good approach?
Good approach to exert pressure. I think the government can be pretty efficient in some ways. Look at the Fugitive Offenders Bill. It can be pushed through within two months, but I don't know how come the all the environmental policies, the sustainability, and all the policy regarding climate change can take years or even decades to come through. I think, well, one of the major obstacles, I think, or two major obstacles, I think, is there are one, sectorial interests, different sectors, different transport sectors may have different sectorial interests. And second, that lacks coordination between government bureaus. Who is going to lead the kind of initiative? Is it the Environmental Bureau or the Information Technology Bureau, or do you need higher ranking government officials like the Chief Secretary to drive through all these initiatives? I mean, it's a big question. But I do think the government owes us a big, responsibility to push all these policies through.
Is it Kevin?
Yeah. I think one of the good sharing from Mark is over 80% of people will charge at home in Netherlands. And that's why home charging is important. So the government incentive for home charging actually is a good supporting policy, I think.
Interesting. I do have a friend who does charging from his office, but in a way that his office is on the first floor, so he has to dangle his cable all the way to the next to the pedestrian sidewalk, right? And then he parked his car right there, and he plugged in. So basically his car is on the ground floor, and then he's the power source is on the first floor, which is pretty amazing thing. Does that work, folks? So because question to Edmund is, if all buses, including 4,000 plus minibuses in Hong Kong, so if they want to make transition to electric, so can they cope with that, or do they need that dangling cable from
so
first floor?
I think the first consideration is not how our grid can cope, is where they park to charge. That's the key issue. Because when they can find a place to park to charge, we can see how we can get our power supply to them. Because imagine, in a depot, they cannot park 4,000 buses in one depot. So it's how they manage to park the buses. Because if you park on the street, obviously it's more difficult to get the power to the street. But we can see how to, we work with our partners to
I asked that question because, you know, from the story I just mentioned, I do know that mini buses do park very tightly in Mong Kok, and so they're, you know, on the first floor, they could actually hang that cable down. And Kevin, also, is there a technology that actually allows a charging cable coming down from the roof? Is that something like that?
I think there's smarter ways. I mean, I've seen their kind of mobile charging station. That's one thing that we can consider, especially in car park, because the problem right now with car park is that you have like two or three set on the wall, built on the wall, and then it's fixed, and then sometimes it's just other gasoline car occupy the space. But then if we have some more, develop some, I mean, there are indeed, and in other countries, they do have kind of a mobile way to charge the car. I mean, right now, their technology, we've seen it in Japan as well. You just leave a car in there, and then everything is automatic, and then you just move it around, and then that charging thing can move around as well. Then you don't need that many. All parkings, we need to have one. Those are expensive as well. And every point in time, at this point, we only have less than 2% of EV in Hong Kong, then we don't necessarily need the all parking space to have an EV charger. But then it's just a lot of mismatch in efficiency. So that kind of mobile charging thing is one way to go.
So a follow-up question for Kenneth and Isabel. Just across the border, Chairman Mark Webb Johnson mentioned that they have fully electric buses, mini buses, whatever. Why is that in Hong Kong that we don't have it here? We used to have BYD, and why do we not here have electric buses?
I think for
Hotel Icon has.
I can tell because I live on the Hong Kong Island because of the topography of our landscape. Our buses is a climb very steep slope, and we like, I don't know whether it's a habit of the Hong Kong people, we like the air conditioning to be always at 20 degrees centigrade. I don't think for that kind of electric consumption, it's feasible for double-decker electric buses to work in Hong Kong. But of course, you know, single-decker could be the key to trial run all these services. Yeah.
Isabel, would you like to say something?
Well, the technology readiness in this area. So building a passenger car, a sedan or SUV is very different than building a double-decker buses or mini buses in Hong Kong. It's Tesla is not producing these products at this point.
Yet.
But the other company that they are building, you know, they're making the battery technology, they're just not there. There are many pilots. We Hong Kong have pilots, many pilots around the world. I think, again, in the next decade, I think it's the direction. It's inevitable. The technology will get more and more mature. So it's not that the policy is there to support it as well. You know, currently, if you we're talking about the zero tax for all commercial vehicles, there is a focus in Hong Kong from the government to push this, move this forward. It is already prioritized. The public transport commercial sector is the key area to go completely EV. So,
thank you, Isabel. And also, there is actually an electric minibus for, you know, at Hotel Icons. If you would like to take a look, it's downstairs. Oh. So, thank you very much, everybody. I think that's all the time we have for this panel. And we are moving to the next part.
Yep, we'll have a coffee break now.
Oh, coffee break part. Okay, thank you. Enjoy your coffee break. Thank you, speakers.
Thank you all so much for the interesting panel discussion and the potential on mobility in Hong Kong.